Come on, let's lift up the name of the Lord. Let's lift up the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. We give you all the glory.
We give you
the name of the Lord in this place. We give you all.
We give you all.
Give him all the glory.
We give you all the glory.
We give you all the glory.
We worship you, our Lord.
Hallelujah.
You are worthy.
Come on. One more time, because he deserves it. He deserves all the glory. Let's lift him up.
Come on, give God a praise. Lift your voice this morning. He's worthy. He's worthy.
Hallelujah.
Lift your voice. Give God a praise this morning.
Glory.
Because he is marvelous in our sight. Oh, God. God is great. And greatly to be praised. I said God is great. And he's greatly to be praised. My soul loves Jesus this morning. Hallelujah. I'm determined to worship God this morning. As we enter into this worship service and into this service this morning, I would ask that you would stand on your feet as we read the Holy Scriptures of God. And that text will be found in Psalms, the 8th division, and the word of the Lord reads, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider, hallelujah, thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and has crowned him with glory and honor. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, and the beast of the field, the fowl of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passeth through the paths of the seas. O Lord our God, how excellent, how excellent, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. God bless the reading and hearing of his word. Now if you would, gather together at the altar with me this morning as we go before the Lord in prayer. Get out of your seat. Come together here at the altar that we might gather together to pray as one body. The Bible says where two or three are gathered, I will be there also. Come, let us come to the altar. Lay our petitions before God. Everybody, open your mouths and pray. Don't just lean on and listen to me as I pray, but pray. Open your mouth and pray unto God. Give him thanks. Oh God, lay your petitions before him. I'm convinced God answers prayer this morning. I'm convinced that he's able to do exceedingly above all that we ask and think. Oh God, Father, in the name of Jesus, in your mighty name, that name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord, to the glory of the Father. Oh God, we come before your presence this morning, thanking you, God. Thanking you for your mercy, for your grace, God, that is unending, God, that knows no limit. God, you have been good to us in spite of ourselves. Hallelujah. We thank you, God, because you are yet mindful of us, God. Even, Lord God, when we disappoint you, Father, you decided, God, God, that you would never leave us, Lord, nor forsake us. And because of that, God, we are so grateful this morning. God, you have saved us. You have blessed us. You have healed us. Oh, God, you have comforted us. God, we thank you this morning. And we bless your name. You're worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy. Hallelujah. It's only because of you that we breathe and move and live and have our being. Oh, mighty God. What a wonderful Savior. What a wonderful God. Now, Father. Now, Father. Enter into this sanctuary. Fill this house, God. Fill this house, God, with your presence. For in your presence, Father, there is joy and pleasure forevermore. In your presence, God, there is healing, Father. Healing of our mind, healing of our body, healing of our soul. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God, have your way. Touch every heart this morning. God, meet every need this morning. Lord God, we know you're able to supply everything that we need. Now have your way, God. Speak to us this morning. To your servant, oh God. Let the word, God, of life find a place in our hearts and in our souls and spirits. that we, God, might be doers and not just hearers of your word. Save someone this morning. Save someone this morning. Baptize them in your name, Father. Hallelujah. Fill them with your spirit. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Have your way this morning. Have your way. We bless you. And we give you thanks for all things, great and small. Thank you, Jesus. Thank God. And amen. Give God a praise on the way back to your seat this morning. I said, give God a praise on the way back to your seat this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, let's lift up the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's lift up the name of the Lord. Because he's a strong tower. And the scripture says, the Bible says, the righteous runneth in and they are safe. How many of you believe today that it's because of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ why we are here today? Hallelujah. Come on and give God a great praise. Come on and give God a great praise. Hallelujah. Those of you who can, let's rise to our feet and give God a standing ovation, because he's worthy of it. He's worthy of it. Give God a standing ovation. Hallelujah. Had it not been for the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, where would we be? For this is the day that the Lord has made. Come on, let us rejoice and be glad in it. Come on. We're going to put our hands together and give God some praise. Come on. I want you to clap your hands and let's give God some praise. Hallelujah. Because this is the day. Here we go.
This is the day.
This is the day. Now let it be.
on, put your hands together and give God some praise. Hallelujah. Come on, he deserves more. Give God some praise. A writer said, when I think about all that God's done for me, you can't help but wonder what a mighty God he has been. It's funny because when they asked me to lead, you know me, I'm a background person. I love a supporting role. I'll probably receive the reward for best supporting actor. But I couldn't help but go back in my mind and think about the day. I was about 23 years old, born and raised in church my whole life, plus 9 months. But yet had not received the infilling of the Holy Ghost. It wasn't until that day. And I remember it clear as a bell. My mother, she's an avid prayer. She loved praying. And she called a prayer meeting in my sister's bedroom. And I was in there. And I remember just seeking the Lord and waiting for that breakthrough to happen. And it seemed forever, your mouth getting dry and you spitting up all over yourself. But then the word of the Lord whispered to me and said, he dwells in the midst of praise. So just praise him and he'll show up. If you can just praise God, he will show up because he's faithful. He is faithful. And I started praising him. And God showed up like I've never seen before in my life. That breakthrough happened for me. And I know it can happen for someone here today. I don't care if you feeling the move of God to come to the altar. I don't care what part of the service it is. That breakthrough can happen any time. Help me say this. Anytime. He dwells in the midst of praise. Just keep praising him. And you will feel God's presence show up. No one have to tap you on the shoulders. No one have to shake you. But you'll feel it come.
It's the sound of breakthrough.
Listen for it. Hallelujah.
Oh, I hear the sound.
This could be your day.
Breakthrough.
My breakthrough is here.
My breakthrough.
Come on.
Is here.
If you believe it, just say it now.
I hear the sound.
Hallelujah.
Of breakthrough.
I hear the sound. Hallelujah. If you're feeling a breakthrough to come into this room today, I want you to stand to your feet and say this with us, okay? Come on, let's raise this up a little bit more. I hear the sound.
I hear the sound of praise.
If you want a breakthrough, just worship right now.
I hear the sound of breakthrough. Oh.
Everything that you need, come on.
Everything that I need.
Yes, God said it.
God has spoken.
I agree. If you believe it today, say this with us. I am healed. Come on, touch your body somewhere. And let God touch you. Hallelujah. It can happen today. Come on, say it one more time. I am healed. Hallelujah. Come on, I am free. And I agree. My breakthrough. Worship. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He dwells in the midst of praise. Come on, let's lift up the name of Jesus. My breakthrough. It can happen right now. It can happen right there. Come on, let's give God a prayer. If you're feeling this in your spirit today, I want you to stand to your feet and say this again. I receive. God has spoken.
My breakthrough is here.
Hallelujah.
My breakthrough.
Hallelujah.
I lift my hands in total adoration unto you. You reign
on the throne, for you are God and God alone.
Because of my cloudy day. I can sing to you. I just want to say
that I love you more than anything.
Let's try this again.
I lift my hands in total,
adoration.
Unto you.
Lord, I adore you.
You
reign,
for
you are God, and God alone. Because of you, I can sing to you this song. I just want to say that I love you more than anything. All right, all right. I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you.
I worship and adore you.
Just want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
That I love you.
Lord, I love you.
More than anything.
More than
Do you love him this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, give God praise. I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you.
I just want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
That I love you.
That I love you.
More.
More.
Yeah. Come on, come on, come on, come on. If you love him, you have to tell him.
I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you
that I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore
you. I worship and adore
you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I
love you, Jesus. Your hand. If you love God this morning, open up your mouth. Give God thanks. I love him because he first loved me. And he loved me with an everlasting love. Because of his love, I have life. I said, because of his love, I have life. Jesus gave his life out of love. Glory to your name. Because of his love, I'm persuaded this morning to bless his name. Precious Jesus, how I love you. How I lift high my voice with your praise. Help me praise to you this morning.
Precious Jesus, how I love,
how I love
you. How hallelujah. I lift high my voice with your praise.
Yes, yes, the love of God is unending.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit. Drench my heart.
Drench my heart as my lips are your prayer.
Here's the part I like the most. For I am persuaded. I am persuaded. Lord, Lord, to love. I have been changed. My heart,
trench my heart
as
my lips
part your grace,
your praise.
For I am persuaded.
Hallelujah. I am persuaded.
Persuaded.
Lord, to love you. I have been changed.
I've been changed.
Yes, Lord.
God is good, and I find no fault. This morning I am. Yeah. There's nothing more desirable to God than a grateful heart. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm grateful this morning. I could have been dead, sleeping in my grave. But because of God's mercy, because of His grace, I'm standing, and I'm standing on the promises of God. His promises are yes and amen. His word will not return unto him void. Everything that God has spoken over your life and over your future, it will come to pass. Glory to God. I'm convinced. I'm persuaded. And I'm determined to run on and seek what the end shall be. Glory! Hallelujah! 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 Glory! I believe every word that God has spoken into my life. His word shall not return unto him void. You don't have to worry, for God is a keeper. He's a keeper, I said. He's a keeper of his word. We bless the Lord today. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm glad this morning. I'm glad this morning to be among the land of the living. Thank you, sir. And I'm honored of God to be here to stand before you this morning. And to everyone this morning, I say praise God. Yes. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes. Men ought to always give God praise. I'm thankful again for this opportunity to stand before you at this day and at this hour to bring to you the word of God. Before I do that, I also want to convey the sentiments of our great leader here in this house, Bishop C. Shawn Tyson and First Lady Krista Tyson. They want me to you to know that they send their love, their prayers, and their support. And they are yet thankful for your prayers and support. We ask that you would continue, as you always have, to pray for them and to support them and to keep them in your thoughts. This morning, I have a word from God. I struggled somewhat when I got the call. You know, we've been taught and been told that we ought to always have something ready. So I had a number of thoughts, and this is nothing new for me. It's always been that way. But God saw fit to toss those out the window. And he wanted me to labor a little bit, I think. But I believe this morning that my labor will not be in vain. Because I believe I have a word from the Lord. I'm grateful this morning for my wife who is here. Thank you. Thank you. It's a blessing to have someone that you know will cover your back. You know, marriage is a very difficult thing sometimes. We've been blessed of God to be married in holy matrimony for over 47 years. And because of that, I am grateful to God. Again, it hasn't always been easy. I heard someone say that marriage is psychological. One is psycho, and the other is logical. And often they change roles at times. But as long as God is in the midst, that's all you need, Elder. You need God in your marriage. That's why they call it holy matrimony. We have so many unions going on that aren't holy today. They haven't been sanctioned by the Almighty God. They started on the wrong foot. Their end shall be destruction. God have mercy on us. Yet I'm grateful today for my children. Grateful for my children. God has favored me with some rock stars. I'm also reminded of the scripture that says, blessed is the man whose quiver is full. And today my quiver is full. All of my children baptized in the name of Jesus. Filled with the Holy Ghost. My daughter's in love. Baptized in the name of Jesus. Filled full of the Holy Ghost. Two of my four grandchildren baptized in Jesus' name. Filled full of the Holy Ghost. And I am eternally grateful to God that he saw fit to favor us, to favor my family. If you'll be faithful to God, I promise you he'll be faithful to you. God's faith is never failing. But I am so delighted this morning to come before you. I won't be before you long, but I have a message that I believe God has given to me. It wasn't one that I thought I would preach when I was asked to preach. But God dropped this in my spirit. And I received a message from the man of God today. And it was a message that confirmed that I'm on the right track. If you ever had to preach, and preachers who are sitting here, you know what I'm talking about. When you're called on to deliver God's word, there's always that search for confirmation. I didn't have that confirmation until early this morning, after I had been away half the night, and something told me to pull up a message from my brother, the Honorable Bishop C. Wayne Brantley, who I have great, great respect for. And the words that he spoke offered to me the confirmation that I was looking for. And before I got here this morning, driving in the car, the Honorable Bishop C. Shawn Tyson sent me a message. And it was double confirmation that the word that God has given me was sent from him. So this morning, if you don't mind standing in deference to the Holy Word of God, and if you would turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 38, rather, beginning with verse 38. Romans 8 and beginning with verse 38. And then if you would hold in ready, if you can, St. John, the 6th chapter, beginning with verse 63. St. John 6 and 63. And the word of the Lord reads, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." John 6 and 63. "It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believe not and who should betray him. And he said, therefore I say unto you that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father." 66 is my emphasis. "From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more." God, we thank you this morning. We enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We bless you, God, because you are worthy of all praise, of all glory, and of all honor. We pray, Lord God, that you will use this your servant this morning. Speak to me and through me. Let my words be your words. My thoughts be your thoughts. Now, Lord God, let everything that is done this morning be done to the glory and the will of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I am thoroughly convinced this morning that we are living in the last days. Make no mistake, the signs are there. It's clear. And because of that, I feel in my heart and in my spirit the Spirit of God urging me to remind us what we should be striving for. And that is to make it to that city called heaven. And though it is a truth that no man, not even the angels, know the day nor the hour, no one knows but God, I feel in my spirit, and I feel the urging of God to remind you that the rapture is imminent. And I have been persuaded and convinced that heaven is the place I want to be. Amen. You see, the rapture, it may not come today, but it could. And if you live your life every day as if the rapture could come, you will be better off by it. It might not come tomorrow, but it could. It might not come days or even years from now, but it could. But I am thoroughly convinced that Jesus is coming soon. You don't have to persuade me. I already know. I don't need to be swayed. I already know. You don't need to try and make a believer out of me. I already believe. The simple truth this morning is that if you have any spiritual awareness, if you are listening to what the Spirit of God is saying to the church this morning, you know it won't be long until we're caught up to meet God in the air. You shouldn't need to be convinced. You already know. And because you already know, it would be a tragedy. Lord have mercy. Of epic proportion if we were to miss the rapture. All that we know, all that we've heard, all that we've felt, all that we've experienced, it would be a tragedy to miss the rapture. I know this is a message. It wasn't intended to make you shout. It was intended to make you think. Think about your purpose, your goal, why you're here. Now is the time to focus. You don't want to lose focus this morning. Look at your neighbor, someone, and tell them, stay focused. Look on the other side. Say, stay focused. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians, its fourth chapter, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. The rapture, I said, is imminent. Is imminent. However, we are living in a day and time where men and women challenge the validity and veracity of the Holy Scriptures. They question the very existence of a God who is perfect because of their imperfections and righteous in all his ways. But I declare to you this morning that the word of God is true, and all scripture is given by the inspiration of God, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So I say to you this morning, yes, let God be true, but every man a liar. We all know the story of Saul, who was on his way traveling on the road to Damascus to do the devil's work. When he had an encounter with God, the Bible tells us in the ninth chapter of the book of Acts that Saul, we now know as Paul, was on his way, but he was yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against disciples of the Lord. The scripture says that he went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of his this way, that way is the way of Christ, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, the story goes on to say, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined around about him a light from heaven, and he fell to the earth. And he heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. And then Jesus said, It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I'd never fully understood that. I had to look it up. And I found that this saying is hard to kick against pricks was a Greek proverb. But it was also familiar to the Jews and anyone who made a living in farming. An ox goad or prick was a stick with a pointed piece of iron at its tip, used to prod the oxen when plowing. The farmer would prick the animal to steer it in the right direction. How many of us have been pricked by God? It's been pricked to steer it in the right direction. Sometimes, just like us, the ox would rebel by kicking at the prick. And this would result in the prick being driven even further into its flesh. How many times have God tried to get our attention with a prick? And because we were so rebellious, and because we kicked against God's word and God's will, the damage that we suffered was unnecessary and far greater than if we would have just obeyed. In essence, in this definition or understanding, the more the ox rebelled, the more it suffered. The more you rebel against God, the more you suffer. There are things that we've been blaming on the adversary all of our lives, Elder Smith. The devil did it. The devil cannot be omnipresent. There's only one being, and that's God Almighty, who's omnipresent. He cannot be everywhere at the same time. The reason you have suffered and the reason you have toiled with pain and disappointment is because of your disobedience. I know it's hard, but I'm going to tell it anyway. Because of our stubbornness and disobedience. And as we read further in that text, the Bible says, and he trembled. I'm sorry. Yes, he trembled and was astonished and said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. You see, when Saul was confronted with Jesus, when he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, his first response was fear. The Bible says he trembled. So now, we read about Paul's persuasion in the text. But this is Paul's first persuasion. And it was precipitated by his fear of God. That fear was enough to cause Paul to change. But I say to you this morning, is it enough to be persuaded? Is it enough to be persuaded? Persuasion is simply influence. It is an influence that works from the outside in. It's something that doesn't come from the inside, but rather it's something or someone outside of you that prevails upon you and wins you over to bring about a change of mind by its impact of reason or physical considerations. In this text this morning, Paul begins by saying, I am persuaded. Again, this was not the first time he was persuaded. The first time Paul was persuaded by fear. Fear is the beginning of wisdom and knowledge of God. The Bible says, the love of God that is all encompassing is altogether good, perfect, and righteous. And in this illustration, there are two external forces that prevailed upon Paul, won him over to bring about a change of mind by their impact. Like Paul, I too had, and many of you quite possibly, had a Damascus Road experience or persuasion. I wasn't on the road to Damascus. I was right up there in the corner of the balcony. And this particular Sunday when I had my Damascus or balcony experience, Sister Marie Harp, I was around 8 or 9 years old, and Sister Marie Harp was teaching our Sunday school class there. And this particular Sunday, she was teaching on heaven and hell. I'm eight, 9 years old. And in those days, they didn't use the word hell. They used a word that is much more descriptive. They called it the lake of fire. I said the lake of fire. I know that's a place I didn't want to go. All I could think about is when I touched the stove, how hot it was and how painful it was. I could not imagine spending all of eternity suffering the agony of my flesh being burned over and over again. Make no mistake, heaven is real, and I don't care what they tell you, what they are preaching to you, hell is as real as heaven is. And I'm urging you to be focused on the prize. So they called it the lake of fire. And in that moment, I was both traumatized and terrified. But from that moment on, Elder Smith, I was persuaded. Like Paul, I was persuaded by fear. So that Sunday afternoon, after Sunday school was over, I was sitting under the balcony where many of you are sitting there now. And there was a bunch of us there, my age, the little rascals, if you will. It was Deacon Tyrone Reed and his brothers, Craig, John, Michael. And there was Deacon Benjamin Levels, Deacon, and his brother Jim. There was Elder Larry Finney. Yes, sir, the elder. He was back there. The Honorable Bishop A. Glenn Brady. He was back there. And my brother, the Honorable Bishop of the 33rd Episcopal District of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. He was sitting back there. We were all sitting back there, cutting up, trying to get away with as much as we could get away with without getting caught. We were, in every sense of the word, Bebe's kids. And the only thing that could save us from this condition was God himself. We're all sitting back there with future deacons, yes, future bishops, yes, elders, and preachers. Yeah. But we weren't listening. We were playing. Yeah. But this particular Sunday, yes, I listened more than I ever listened before. I couldn't tell you all of the messages that Bishop Raymond L. Robinson was preaching before that Sunday. I have no idea what he said. I really can't tell you the name of his message that day when I sat under a balcony. All I could think about was the lake of fire. I wasn't listening. I wasn't paying any attention to anything but that. However, this particular Sunday, some reason I paid enough to attention to what was going on that I understood what the altar call was. And I was persuaded in my heart and spirit and mind that I was going to step out by faith so that I wouldn't go to the lake of fire. So when Bishop Robinson, Raymond L. Robinson, gave the invitation, I immediately got up from my seat and began to make my way to the altar. I was fully persuaded I was going to be baptized in Jesus' name this morning. As I began to walk down the center aisle, my focus was laser-like. And the power of persuasion, Elder Smith, was in full effect. I was not going to the lake of fire. Sister Marie Harp had persuaded me and convinced me that the lake of fire was somewhere I didn't want to be. So I was on my way. All of a sudden, I heard a voice cry out. And he called my name. Gary! No, it wasn't the voice of God. But the voice called my name and said, Gary, get back here. It was the voice of the bishop of the 33rd Episcopal District of the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, Bishop C. Wayne Brantley. And when he called my name, I did exactly what he did, what he said to do. I turned around. I turned around, I was obedient, and I went back to my seat. You see, the problem was, I was still persuaded. I didn't want to go to hell. That's not the problem. I wasn't determined. Many of us have been persuaded by this great gospel. But are you determined? Determination, unlike persuasion, works from the inside out. It is something that you must desire to do. My desire is to please God all the days of my life. Determination is the quality of mind that reaches definite conclusions. It is a decision of character to be resolute and to be, as the scripture tells us, steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Determination helps you to ignore and overcome distractions and obstacles. Determination helps you to stay the course. Determination would have helped me not to look back or step back or turn back or sit down. Determination will help you to move forward. Forward in God. To press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So after you've been persuaded, there is more to be done. You must be determined and committed to the will of God. You must be resolute and decisive in your decisions to please and obey God. Determination helps to stabilize you. It helps you to be rooted and grounded. The Bible says, like a tree planted by the waters. Yes, you've been persuaded, but are you determined? I don't need, you don't need, we don't need to be persuaded. We just need to be determined. We've been persuaded. Nothing can change my mind about how I feel about God. Nothing can change my mind about my desire to please God. The only thing that can stop me, not the devil, not people, not sickness, not philosophies, not anything, but the only thing that can stop me from obeying God is me. I'm determined to please God. And the best way I know how is through obedience. In the book of Genesis, we find the first man, Adam. The Bible doesn't tell us with any great detail the relationship between God and Adam. However, we can draw from what the scripture tells us some theories and possibly some conclusions to be made. Because of all the things God gave to Adam to do, he needed time with God to be taught by God. He had to be taught how to tend the many varieties of the trees and vegetation in the garden, the plants. He was given the task of naming all the animals that God created. And the Bible says God brought them to him. This took time. Time is the necessary aspect of relationship. You have to spend time with God to have a relationship with God. You can't even have a relationship with your family unless you spend time. So these things that God was teaching and telling Adam, we can conclude, took time. So here is Adam, who had neither an earthly mother or an earthly father. So it is logical to look at Adam and assume that he looked to God not only as his creator, but as his parent. I believe God took on many roles. Not only was God his parent, he was Adam's teacher, his mentor, his advisor, his tutor, his counselor, and his friend. There had to be, that is the only logical conclusion, there had to be a relationship between Adam and his God. The Bible doesn't say how long Adam was in the garden before the fall, but we can assume at this point that there was time spent together with God. Not only was Adam spending time with God, he was learning and knowing God. So Adam not only knew God, he knew the ways of God. Can you imagine being in the presence of God? Being able to feel and to hear not just a small still voice, but a voice thundering from heaven. Adam was in the presence of God, but yet, he still failed. I have often in my mind wondered how anyone could walk with Jesus, talk with Jesus, eat with Jesus, and not believe Jesus and not obey Jesus. All that I know, all that I believe, if I ever got in the presence of God where I could touch him, where I could see him, I could talk to him and he would talk to me as a man talks to another man, I would be so eternally grateful. There is no way that I turned my back on God. But Adam experienced all of this and he failed. He knew who God was. He was persuaded of that a long time ago. He knew that God was his creator, that God was omniscient, omnipotent, all-knowing and all-seeing. He knew it, but he failed. The Bible tells us that obedience is better than sacrifice. And I took a moment to ponder on that. I said, obedience is better than sacrifice. And for a moment, I was afraid to go down that lane. But I'm going down because I believe God is giving. When we look at the beginning in the book of Genesis, where it all began, and the fall of Adam, and that single act that condemned all of humanity for ages to come. It was all because of Adam's disobedience and failure to obey the commandment of God. In John 14, the Bible tells us, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. There is no, I believe, single or greater act or sin that has a greater consequence than the sin of disobedience. Because of one man's disobedience and sin, it entered the world and death came through sin. This underscores the biblical truth that obedience is better than sacrifice. For if Adam would have obeyed God and not eaten the forbidden fruit, Here we go. This is where I was. There would have been no need for sacrifice. Do you hear me what I'm saying? I know that sacrifice is noble, courageous, self. It's a selfless act that needs to be appreciated and celebrated. For after all, Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice and came down 40 in two generations and sacrificed his life that we who are dead in our sins and trespasses against God might be redeemed. However, if Adam would have obeyed God, there wouldn't be a need for redemption. It all begins with obedience and the determination to obey God at all costs. I will forever be grateful for the sacrifice that God made, sending his son down to die and suffer and to bleed and to be buried and to rise again and to completely eradicate my sins. I'm forever eternally grateful. But I can't help to think, what would the world look like today if Adam had been determined and not just persuaded? What would your life look like this morning if you had been determined and not just persuaded? Mercy. Hallelujah. I submit to you this morning that if you don't do anything, obey God. If you don't do another thing, obey God. Because if you obey God, everything in your life, everything in your future will line up with God's sovereign will and desire for your life. He said, I know the thoughts I think towards you. They're thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. God wants you to prosper and be in good health and live long. Jesus. What would life be? What would my life, what would your life be if we would have just obeyed God in the beginning? We wouldn't have as many knots that we have on our head. Wouldn't have as many cuts and bruises on our body. Needless pain inflicted. I don't know why in human nature it is so difficult for man, for women, for us to obey. It's not in our original nature. It can't be. We were created by God in his image. Our DNA, not ribonucleic acid. It is the divine nature of an awesome God that is resident in us. It was God's design. It was a design that came from his mind. We are wondrously and marvelously made. What kind of mind can design all of the intricacies of the human anatomy? Hallelujah. I'm convinced that it wasn't a big bang happening. No, there was too many details and intricacies for this to just happen. There's no one who's as wise as God. And in his divine intellect, he began to design us. Design not just our bodies and our minds. He began to design our futures. He began to order our steps. And he said, you know, I don't want to make anybody love me. I don't want to make anybody obey me. I want them to love me and obey me because I love them. So God designed us in his image and determined that we would be blessed. But because of our disobedience, we are now in the predicament that we are in today. And I'm concerned this morning that the church has lost some of its determination. They're persuaded because they show up every Sunday, elder. Show up to every prayer meeting. They praise and worship God in this place. But when they leave these walls, are they obeying God? It's easy to obey God when you're in his presence, even though the disciples, some of them had difficulty. And they were in the presence of God. But for us, it's easy when we come together with like people and like minds to be obedient to God. But what about when you leave here? Are you focused? I know you're persuaded, but are you focused? Are we focused this morning? And are we determined to run on to see what the end will be? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you again for being mindful of us. Hallelujah. That you would send the word that would heal us, not just our mortal bodies, a healing that would heal our minds, our spirits. One that would open our eyes and give us an understanding that we ourselves could not have gained. It's only because of you, God. It's only because of you that we're able to stand, move, live, and have our being. Now, Father, look upon us this morning. Shine the spotlight from heaven on our souls, on our hearts. And if you find anything, God, that is unlike you, anything that displeases you, God, take it out. Cleanse me. Wash us with hyssop. From the crown of our heads to the soles of our feet. Oh God, make us righteous so that we, Father, might be able to see your face in peace. It is our desire, God, to know you in a better way. It is our desire, God, to make heaven our home. Help us, God, to be determined not to disobey you, God, but to believe every word and to do everything that you have charged us to do. God, we thank you for this word because it was light unto me and it was light unto us. And not only was it light, it was life. And we thank you for that. We thank you for that, God, causing us to think more seriously about what our goal, our ultimate goal is. We thank you, Lord God, that we are covered by your blood. And this morning, God, we humbly bow before your will and your command. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, we are moving towards what is now called the opening of the doors of the church. As the altar workers move to the altar at this time, this is your opportunity. If you're living outside of what we call the ark of safety, there's room for you aboard the ship of Zion. God loves you. He wants you. He needs you. I know we've heard God is in need of nothing, but he needs you in the sense that he wants you to love him and to obey him. So at this time, if there's anyone who has been touched, you know who you are. It's not too late. It's not too late. God has given you the opportunity to come before him this morning and to submit to his will. Come, Jesus is calling. He's calling for you. Now, if you're here this morning and this message has caused you to think about your life and where you are in God, and you want to increase your faith and your commitment and your determination, you can come to the altar now. Allow God or the elders to pray over you. The Bible says a threefold cord is hard to break. Come down with me to the altar and covenant with one of the elders, altar workers, and let God be in the midst. I'm a firm believer that God answers prayer. He's answered my prayer so many times. God has never failed. If you're here, there's still time. Come. Struggling this morning with something, and you need an answer from God, I promise you, if you come with a spirit of expectation, you'll find your answer here at the altar. Let us stand to our feet all over the building. Minister Paul, Elder Paul, would you come and pray over this congregation?
Let us pray. Father, in the holy and the matchless name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we come, Lord God, right now, humbled, mind, body, soul, and spirit, that the almighty, wondrous God has sent unto us a wondrous word out of your heart, out of your spirit, releasing and demonstrating, Lord God, your compassion, your mercy, and your grace. Those essences of you, Lord God, are mighty in our midst this day. You, the Almighty God, who has loved us with an everlasting love. No matter our stumblings, our trippings, our turning backs, our looking aside, God, yet you have been long-suffering, not willing that any should perish. You've sent us a mighty word today, Lord God, to allow us to reflect, to look inward, and to seek out in the name of the Lord Jesus diligently if there be anything, Lord God, displeasing unto thee. What a love, what mercy, what grace. The compassion that you even woke us up this morning, starting us on our way, Lord God, with a divine encounter with you. This word, Lord God, is quick and powerful, dividing even asunder the one and the marrow. Lord, let us allow the word of God to work within us, and in obedience, Father, reflect upon that which has been given. God, anoint and bless this your people. You have called us with purpose in the name of Jesus. You have designed us, Lord God, each one significant, important in their place. You who sat and wondrously and meticulously made us, knowing even every hair upon our head, Lord, you thought it out and you planned it, Lord God. And then you, Lord God, chose us. Help us no longer to believe lies and to agree in the name of the Lord Jesus against words that dispute the truth of God. But Lord God, with boldness and confidence to come before the throne of grace to obtain the help that we need in the time of trouble. But not only in trouble, Lord God, let us come in the name of Jesus before your presence with thanksgiving and joy and praise. In the good times, store it up, Father. Lord, that which will cover us and carry us in the days to come. Bless your servant. Renew him. Refresh him. Lord, pour back into him. And in this, your people, God, the passion of God in this place, this day. Let each feel and understand the touch of God, of love, that is resonating in this house. Bless each of us, Lord God, to do better, to become better. And Lord God, to seek to become more like you. You said, when we see you, we shall be like you. Help us to search to see you, that we might give you glory, honor, and praise in our everyday living. This we ask, Lord God, and believe by faith, and declare and decree that the sick among us shall be healed. Let healing in the name of Jesus, body, soul, mind, and spirit, move in this house. Let us leave changed. Let us leave healed. Let us leave delivered. Let us leave blessed. And make us, God, a blessing in the name of Jesus, that we might ever be found pleasing, God, in your sight. Now we commend all things into your holy hands, asking you, Lord God, to smile upon and bless our pastor, Bishop C. Shawn Tyson, and Pastor Krista Tyson. Touch them. Touch the children, the grandchildren, Lord. Touch everything that concerns them. Heal their bodies. Renew their strength. All that they have poured out, Lord God, in these 10 months of the year, Lord God, judge it to be righteous and pour back into them divinely and holy, Lord God. Remember our children, the young people, Lord God. Oh, God, give them solid ground to stand upon. Anoint the great leaders that you have put in place to carry them, Lord God, into new dimensions. And we will ever live to give you glory, honor, and praise. As this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
All the workers, you may return. God bless you this morning. Thank you for your attentiveness. Thank you for your patience. We have some announcements right before the offering that I would like to read in your hearing. And then Evangelist Sherry Brogdon has a special announcement. And then she will, immediately after I give these announcements, she will come and make her special announcement. October the 15th, Calvary announcements. Tuesday's noon in-person Bible class will be replayed at 7 p.m. on the YouTube channel. Thursday, October 19th, saturation prayer and exhortation from 6 to 7 p.m., followed by women's ecclesia and the A1 Brothers small group meeting. Friday, October 20th, Celebrate Recovery convenes from 6 to 7:30 p.m. Sunday Academy, Kids Zone, it's a reminder, has resumed in person at 9 a.m. to 9:40 a.m. meetings. Sunday's Academy's Kids Zone has resumed in person teaching that will begin at 9 a.m. every Sunday morning to 9:40 a.m. Next Sunday, Health and Wellness Breast Cancer Awareness Sunday. A reminder, again, Dominion is requesting donations for their fall festival. And that will begin, that will take place on October the 28th. And we have some things to celebrate this week. And we have a list of this week's birthdays. Let's give God a praise for birthdays. This week through October, from October 8th through October 14th, we are delighted to celebrate the birthday of our own Deacon Mervyn Wagner. Yes. Ask him how old he is. Also, we want to celebrate Sister Maxine Brown. Amen. Brother Jamie Carpenter. I remember when you were born. And my own cousin, Brother Rod Cheatham. Happy birthday, sir. Dr. Constance Longmire. Brother Anthony Nwanko, Sister Sharon Nwanko, they share the same birthday, October the 14th. Sister Rachel Oliver and Elder David Thompson. Let's give another round of appreciation for the celebration of these birthdays. At this time, Sister Evangelist Sherry Smith has a special announcement.
To the household of faith, we say praise the Lord. Need to highlight a couple of announcements and to make you aware of one. On November the 4th and 5th, Calvary will be having a holiday bazaar. November the 4th and 5th. All of those who would like to participate, either with your baked goods or you do holiday decorations or something that will enhance the holiday season, you are invited to come and you're able to have a table, and we're all able to come and make this a marketplace so that we don't have to go to Hobby Lobby or Michael's or something. There's gifts and talents right here in the house, amen. So this holiday bazaar, you're able to register today. Now you can go online to our Calvary for You site and give your registration information. Or you can see myself, and this morning I'm going to recruit Sister Quinn Gilchrist. You can see either one of us to participate. But please begin signing up on today. On Sunday, October the 22nd, which is Pink Sunday, we're asking all the ladies especially to wear pink. And gentlemen, we know that there's ties with a little fleck of pink or something in it. But the main thing is that we come in unity for that special breast cancer awareness. It has touched so many of our lives personally, as well as our families. So it's just not about wearing the pink, it's about praying. It's about believing God. And finally, we're preparing for an awesome event on November the 19th. Not only is it Big Give Sunday, but we're also going to celebrate the elevation of our pastor to the bishopric, the Honorable C. Shawn Tyson. Amen. We're going to be able to celebrate the debt reduction, and we're also going to be able to celebrate the 13th pastoral anniversary of Bishop and First Lady Tyson. So we have a lot going on, and you're going to hear more about it, but we wanted you now, please circle that date on your calendar, November the 19th. God bless.
We've heard the announcement. Let us govern ourselves accordingly. I heard someone say, evangelist, that real men wear pink. It's offering time. Amen. Amen. Time to attempt to give back to God all that He has given to us. We know it's impossible, but we should not stop trying. God has blessed all of us with so much. It is our responsibility to give unto Him as He has given unto us. Officers, would you come forward now? Minister Nathan, would you come pray over the offering?
Father, in Jesus' name, God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to give on today, Lord. I'm asking that you would bless those that are desirous to give but have not to give, Lord God. Fulfill every need, Lord. You know everything that we stand in need of. Bless this house, bless this church, and bless your people, Lord. We'll forever give your name praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Go forth now. If you have in need or in need of a tithing contribution envelope, raise your hand at this time, and the ushers will come forward. I'm getting a look from my wife of 47 years. I did something wrong. Forgive me. Go forth to serve. Was that right? Yes. I think today we're going to walk. So if you're not aware, there are many options outside of the options of giving hard money. You can offer your offering electronically through Cash App. And that Cash App for this church is $MTC Youngstown. $MTC Youngstown. And also on Giveafly and PayPal. That's it for the Mount Calvary Pentecostal Church. Let us be mindful to give God his tenth. That's not something that you have a choice to make. Let us be obedient. It is a command of God. So if you would at this time, everyone stand. And ushers, would you lead us out from the rear? Praise to God for music ministry this morning. Brother John and Brother Alec holding it down over there, as they always do. You know, I'm a music person. Thank God. At this time, Minister Nathan, right before we dismiss, has a special announcement he would like to make.
Praise the Lord, Calvary. Real quickly, after this morning service, if right down here up front, if I can meet with all of our ecclesia leaders. You know, we have an event coming up on October the 28th. We're doing our treat trail extravaganza for the children as a part of our Harvest Fest this year. And if I could just meet with all ecclesia leaders just for about 5 minutes, right up here up front, right after service.
Thank you again for your patience and for your attentiveness. Elder Smith, would you dismiss us?
Thank you, Jesus. Let's put our hands together for the message and the messenger. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We want to pray the blessings of God upon him, his family, and upon our pastor, upon the family of God, the Mount Calvary Pentecostal Church, the Royal Apostolic House of Calvary. Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift our hands unto thee. In the name of Jesus, Lord God, according to Song of Solomon 4:4, as we have our hands lifted unto thee, buckled upon our wrists, the bucklers and the shields of the mighty men of war, for we do war in Jesus Christ's name. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray for the peace of our address. We pray for peace of mind to be upon our pastor. We pray for peace in our spirits, in our souls, and in our bodies. Heal us all and make us whole. We thank you. We praise you for your word that has gone forth. Give us obedient spirits. Give us, hallelujah, determination in our minds. Say it with me. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the everlasting covenant, make this congregation perfect in every good work. Work in us that which is well pleasing in your sight, to whom be honor, glory, henceforth, now and forever. We ask these blessings. We pronounce these blessings in Jesus Christ's name. Amen and amen. God bless you.